Welcome to today's webinar, Interview Like a Talk Show Host, Land the Job, sponsored by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. My name is Kara Fleury, Associate Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is Jason Levin, founder of Ready, Set, Launch, LLC. Before we start, I have just a few reminders for our audience. Questions are welcome throughout today's webinar. Simply type them in the question area as you have them in real time. I will hold on to all questions until the speaker has finished the presentation. We will begin the Q&A session during the last 20 minutes of the call. Remember that no question is silly. Every question is worth asking. Now's your chance to hear from an expert in the field. Please note that today's presentation will be recorded and made available to all registrants within 3 days on our YouTube channel. Additionally, I will be passing along a copy of the recording in my follow-up email to you over the next few days. And finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me in that same question drop-down on your control panel. Without further ado, I'd like to go ahead and introduce our presenter. Jason Levin founded Ready, Set, Launch after a career in brand management at Unilever, consulting at Accenture, and employer branding at Vault.com. He helps his clients land that next job, get a promotion, make a career change, or transition into retirement. Jason also enjoys speaking on and moderating panels and presenting career development seminars and webinars at staff retreats, conferences, and training sessions. Jason, we're excited to get started, so I will go ahead and turn this right over to you.
Thank you, Kara. Thank you so much. Always a pleasure to be with Georgetown Alumni Career Services, and thank you to everybody on the line. Certainly, you have options and choices with your time. Thank you for being here with me. And to get a better sense of who's on the line, I've got some poll questions to just get an understanding of who's out there. So, Kara, if you can run the polls, please.
So, Jason, the first question, I believe my interview skills are, we have 16% of our alumni feel that they are below average in their skills, 59% average, 25% above average. No one is an interview ninja.
Well, after this webinar, well, let's see if we can get some more ninjas into that category.
So this question being, what was the last time you did an informational interview? 25% less than 1 month ago, 11% 1 to 3 months, 8% 3 to 6, 30% 6 to 12 months, and 26% of our alumni have never conducted an informational interview.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Jason, 24% of our alumni have 0 to 5 years of experience, 8% 5 to 10, 14% 10 to 15, 22% 15 to 20. The majority of the alumni on the line have 20 plus years of experience.
And what was the percentage on that?
33%.
Thank you. Welcome, everybody.
All right, everyone, one last final poll. Okay, Jason, what Georgetown school did you graduate from? 46% undergrad, 9% MBA students, 16% law grads, 25% graduate school, 4% med school.
Yeah. Wonderful. Well, thank you, Kara, and again, welcome to everybody on the line. So why don't we get started and get into the interview chair and start interviewing like a talk show host. All righty. So a little bit more background on me and why I do what I do. It all started back in 1990 when I was a sophomore in high school. And with my two younger brothers and I, we were growing up in northern New Jersey. And my father lost the only job that he ever had working in the garment district in Manhattan. And so quickly, my two younger brothers and I became aware of the uncertainty and unpleasantness that comes with unemployment. 6 months into his unemployment, we were on the school's free lunch program, and we were shopping in food pantries. And so you could say that I was the wackiest teenager you ever met because I wanted to know why. So why is it that people get jobs? Why do people lose jobs? Why do people get promoted? Why do people not get promoted? And so if we were friends in college, I was helping you mock interview. I was helping you with your internship search. By then, I already had subscriptions to the Wall Street Journal and to Forbes and to Fortune. I had done informational interviews, even though they weren't called that, or at least that as the way I understood it, with the families I was babysitting for and doing odd jobs for. And so throughout my career, even though I don't have an HR background, I have an enormous amount of respect for the hiring process, all things human capital. And so when HR would call for help with training or development or recruiting, interviewing, that's something that I always held my hand up for because I felt it was really important to understand who were the right people for our organization. But if they didn't have a place in our organization, I was always curious, where did they go? And so you could always say that coaching, mentoring, professional development, and recruiting have always been part of my core interests and the reason I've gone full-time into career and outplacement coaching. And so today's interview agenda is going to run in the following. So we're going to talk about some Hoya interview fears for those that had answered some of my questions in advance. I want to talk about talk show hosts because I think talk show hosts know interviewing. We're going to talk about strategic informational interviewing, my interview preparation checklist, and then the different formats of interviewing, phone screen, Skype, video conference, in person. And then how to close on every interview. And so to all who submitted an interview response in advance of this webinar, thank you in Hoya Saxa. I appreciate your insight. I appreciate your candor. Appreciate you giving me a better understanding of what you're going through. And that helped influence the topics that I'm going to talk about. And so I want to generate a couple of themes. I'm not going to go word for word, but here are a couple of themes that I've noticed in the responses that I got. So there were definitely concerns around nerves before and during an interview, and so we'll talk about that. Coming across poised and confident in an interview, very important. Concerns about telling a clear story, totally understand. Not feeling prepared for the interview. And it's been 10 to 20 years since I interviewed. Where to begin? Because, you know, when you think about it, if you've worked 15, 20, 30 years, how do you string out or tell that story? And if you've taken time out of the workforce and how do you, and coming back in, how do you tell that story? So we're really going to, you know, talk about storytelling as a very important piece in interviewing. But to build that story, it really begins with listening. And so for me, the aspiration is always to be able to ask good questions. And so that's why I love talk show hosts and some of the original talk show hosts. And so the aspiration usually begins with some of these people. I want to start with Oprah Winfrey. Throughout the globe, known for her award-winning talk show that ran 25 years, and arguably the most influential woman in America. A woman of many talents, Oprah hosted over 3,800 shows where her emotional ad-lib delivery made anyone want to share their story. Larry King, over a 25-year award-winning career with CNN, Larry King has interviewed over 50,000 people. Dubbed the most remarkable talk show host, King's unique conversational approach to interviewing brought talk format to primetime news. Barbara Walters, since the 1960s, Barbara Walters entered TV and most renowned for her 20-year award-winning presence on the show 2020. Known for personality interviews and scoop interviews, Barbara knows how to talk to anyone about anything. James Lipton, host of the award-winning Inside the Actors Studio, where for 18 years he has conducted over 250 interviews with actors, directors, and writers. Audiences are mesmerized by the facts he's able to uncover about his subjects. I love these interviewers because they are so good at what they do. And while some of them are no longer doing their work, they have really inspired the next generation of folks that go out and ask really good questions. And so I think there's some really good themes that we can learn from these wonderful talk show hosts as you go and prepare for your next informational interview, your next actual interview. The first is they're all confident and calm. The moment they go on screen, they're warm, they have a presence, they make you want to talk to them. And more that I talk with executive search professionals, hiring executives, the biggest thing that comes out is, you know, when you finally get that to that final three that are going for the particular job, you know, whether it's a C-suite job or, you know, really an experienced professional job. In a word, it's chemistry. And so the ability to be confident and calm going into those interviews really helps you create that chemistry with the people in front of you. These four all share being really prepared and curious. They're interested in the person, and they've got questions. And there's a genuineness on how they ask their questions because they have prepared in understanding the person's background in front of them and who they are and kind of getting the hows and whys behind it. They're also genuine and passionate. And let's never forget, and I say this often, that people hire people. And people hire people they like. And they there's an excitement in these four. And so as you're going through these interviews, being genuine and being excited about what you do really matters. And finally, structured. So these four interviewers have a plan of attack. They have a roadmap. On how they're going to interview the person in front of them. And you feel that as they're going through the questions that they have, whether it's James Lipton's blue note cards or some of the papers that they have in front of them, their outlines, and there's a structure in how they go about things. So let's begin to take these elements and how we can begin to practice this wonderful craft. And the way you can practice this wonderful craft is really in strategic informational interviewing, because it's an opportunity for you to test ideas, to learn new things, to meet new people, to gain new knowledge. And for me, there's a three-step approach to informational interviewing. There's the ask, there's the conversation, and then there's the follow-up. And so as we begin to think about the ask, when I was in high school, I got some really great advice from a family friend who is an actuary executive. And he said something that still resonates with me today. He said, Jason, if you ask for a job, you'll get advice. If you ask for advice, you will get a job. And so everybody in the line, I want you to think of yourself as advice seekers, not job seekers, because that will help you in your process of getting the informational interviews that you need and making the ask and making the ask in the right way. And so here's a sample ask. Dear alum, I noticed your interesting background on LinkedIn, admire your career path. As I think about my career, I'm interested in learning more about your work at SME or wherever that looks like. Would you have 20 minutes in the near future for a conversation? I promise to be respectful of your time and would truly value your insights and advice. Look forward to our discussion. Regards, fellow Hoya. And there's a couple of pieces in here. You know, you have to use this exact language, but admiration is really a big thing. You know, what is it that you enjoy about them specifically? Commonality, we have Georgetown in common. You could also say we have so-and-so in common. What is it that you have in common with that person? And then the last piece is you're not asking for dinner. You're not asking for lunch. You're asking for a quick 20 minutes. It could be coffee. It could be over the phone, depending on the person's availability. So how you ask really matters in getting that informational interview. Where can you look? Still remain a fan of the online tools, so LinkedIn, Google. And if you're a younger Hoya, we do have some younger Hoyas on the line. Hoya Gateway is a great way for you to engage the Hoya community and a great way for you to find other Hoyas with experience that want to share their knowledge. As you begin to do your outreach, no doubt you're going to start with an email, and the person may or may not get back to you immediately. And so let's not forget that as the weeks maybe turn into months, it's not that unusual after a couple of months go by to leave the person a voicemail. And if you're really interested in getting time with that person and several months have gone by, it doesn't hurt to write a letter. And so how you acquire these informational interviews really matters. And then when you finally do get the meeting, I really think it's important to be confident and to go into those conversations and not as a box to check, but really showing appreciation, showing a level of confidence, and being happy to see them, just like Oprah. And if you take an Oprah approach into your informational interviews, you'll be a little bit up, you'll be smiling, and already excited to engage with this person. As you begin to start the conversation, there is somewhat of a structure that you can use. So in the beginning, be a little chatty. Don't get into your elevator speech. You know, see how the person's doing. Enjoy the fact that you have time with them. As you start getting into the actual meat of the conversation, I'm a big fan of using an inverse pyramid. I like to think of big ideas to very, very small ideas. The reason I have the individual at the top is because we all want to talk about ourselves. And if we're going to interview like a talk show host, we need to informational interview like a talk show host. So making sure that it's about them and making sure that you're focusing on them. Depending on the type of organization they're in, you know, individuals could be part of a team, which is part of a larger division, part of a overall employer, and within an industry. So there's different layers that you could be talking to that person and getting their vantage point on how they see the world. And so it could be very simple things like, what advice can you offer me on my job search? How do you approach getting into this field? What would you like what do you like about your work? What are the types of people who succeed in your organization or field? This is an amazing self-awareness question, because as they start to articulate, well, here are the types of people that do well either on my team or in the company or in this field, that's some really great feeders for when you get into your actual interviews and they're asking you, why is it that you want to work on this team or in this company? You can revert back to the conversations that you have. What info sources are you using to stay current? So read what they read and understand the language that they're using and so that you can speak this organization's or industry's lingua franca. And where do you think the industry is going? Because it can be helpful for you as you start to think about where you can orient your job search. This is incredibly important because not everything that exists online. And so as you get a good set of data points, using this structure can really help you understand where the opportunities are, where the opportunities might be, and what doors, you know, you really should be closing for yourself. And so the things that you can be learning from an informational interview is essential. How your motivations match the interests, motivations, passions of people working in the field. How your skill set matches the needs of the industry organization. How your personality matches the culture of the industry or organization. How success is defined. Any essential feedback to help you. Any news that might not be online. I was actually working with a university swim coach. And the swim coach had been a swim coach his entire career. And after 15 years, he wanted to make a career switch. And so as we started to look at the opportunities in front of him, and as he started to have these conversations, he started to realize he could go into university admissions, he could go into recruiting, because actually a big part of being a swim coach is actually recruiting. And so as he was having these conversations, he started to recognize the things that he could be pulling out of his background to make that transition. And so a year later, he got a recruiting job within an accounting and finance-focused recruiting firm. And now 3 years later, he's a recruiter within a Big Four, all because he focused his informational interviews and was able to map the things that he learned into his story. And so after your informational interviews, you want to follow up, and following up is really key. Thank you note in less than 12 hours because we live in a 24/7 society, and you just want to make sure that you can get that note out there. What did you learn from the conversation? Make sure that you have a tracking file and that you're putting the notes in on what you learned from that conversation. And did that person promise you anything? Or did they say, you know what, let me make an introduction, or let's touch base again in 6 months? Well, you should mark your calendar to be able to follow up with them, because it's not just about the informational interview, but all the necessary follow-up that comes from that. And so making sure that you have a tracking file is very helpful, because it helps you understand, what did you learn from this person? And who did they introduce you to, so that when you do land, you can go back and look at your file and see at all the people that helped you, and so that you can make sure that you can show gratitude and keep that conversation going. So your informational interviewing, these informal conversations are turning into formal ones, and now it's time to go in and prepare for the real interview. And there's nobody that prepares like James Lipton. I love, love, love his blue note cards and how he pulls things out of his actors and directors' backgrounds. And no, you don't have to do that for the people that you're interviewing with, but at least going in with that mindset that you want to be prepared. And so here's my preparation checklist: mindset, professional appearance, understanding the organization, understanding the interviewer, your story, and articulating the match. You want to go in and understand that it is completely normal to get nervous for an interview. You want to make sure that your mind is in the right place when you're meeting that person or that series of people. And so, yes, get nervous, but also understand what calms you down. Is it meditation? Is it yoga? Is it exercise? I'll tell you what got me into my happy place. In my mind, whenever I was nervous going in for interviews, this is the song that would be going through my head. I feel pretty, oh so pretty. And now you understand why I did not go into the arts. But it got me goofy. It brought me down from a nervousness of 10 to a nervousness of 3 or 4. And so I was able to have a conversation with myself before having a conversation with others. And what you want to be doing is repeating that successful scenario, that you're going to be leveraging all the research that you did. You're going to have a great engagement with that person or that series of people. You have prepared. You're ready to win. You own the job. And so at the end, enjoy the experience and having that right mindset so that you can go in and win on each of your interviews. And so if you're going to interview like a talk show host, you need to look like a talk show host. So bring your A appearance when you're going in for these interviews. As you're preparing for the organization, think about it from either a private sector or a nonprofit or a government perspective. Each of these organizations have a mission, culture, and a set of organizations that might be doing similar types of work. And so as you begin to think about your interview with this organization, make sure you're clear and you understand what their mission is. Get a sense of their culture, either from their website or the people that you're talking to. Competition, what are the similar types of organizations that are doing this type of work? As you get more into nonprofit roles and private sector roles, then it's more about the sector and industry, the business model, the customers and lines of business, recent news. So if it's private sector and they're public, you can be looking at their 10K, looking at, you know, do they do B2B, business to business, or business to government, or business to consumer. On the nonprofit side, looking at their 990s and how they make money. So is there fundraising through foundations, major gifts, corporate gifts? What does that look like? And, you know, one thing that I love to use as an interview prep tool is actually YouTube. So many organizations have their employees talking about what it's like to work inside those organizations. And so you can hear employees talking about what it's like to work at their employer and then even leverage that in your interviews as you're talking about why you wanted to work there. You really resonated when person X was talking about culture or whatever that looks like. So there's a whole host of preparation that you can be doing in terms of the organization. And then, of course, the interviewer. And so you've got, you know, their social media footprint, because they're certainly looking at you. Their role in the organization, is it a peer? Is it a supervisor? A supervisor's supervisor? Is it the recruiter? Remember that everybody matters in this process. There are some nuances between recruiters and hiring managers. Recruiters tend to focus either on certain competencies, your story, your motivations. Hiring managers, hiring executives are closer to the work, closer to the business, and so they're going to be really doing a deeper dive on certain types of experiences. And again, it's never too late to informational interview as you're going through the process and keeping the people that you've connected with just informed on how you're moving from, first interview to second interview to third interview. As you begin to think about your story, and this is really important because you're going to have the microphone. You really need to get your story straight as it relates to the role, the team, and the organization. So you need to really begin to think about what is it they're looking for? What is it they care about? What's important to them? So when they either ask you, tell me about yourself, or walk me through your resume, this is not about, you know, your family and, you know, the things you've enjoyed. And this is really a structured way to show your alignment with what you think they're looking for, as well as what you bring to this organization. So for those on the line that have 15, 20, 20 plus years of experience, really important first to be reflecting favorably on your past colleagues, your past bosses. We all know that there have been bumps in the roads in your career, but remember that even if it wasn't a perfect ending in a particular experience, that does not need to come out in an interview. It's also really important that you summarize and amplify relevant information, especially for those that have more than 15 years of experience. So tell me about yourself or walk me through your resume answer should not exceed, you know, 3 or 4 minutes. For people that have less than 10 years of experience, you can get through it faster, probably around 2 minutes. And really what you're looking to do is talk about your motivations and your transitions and helping the person in front of you understand not only what you did, but why you did what you did. Why role, why sector, why employer? Again, this gets back to understanding the research that you've done and your motivations for why you want to go into this particular role. Key accomplishments. I had a an attorney I was working with that was transitioning into a C-suite role, and it was a non-attorney role. It was really leading the organization. And one of their key accomplishments was that they had run a really large organization of above 100 million in annual revenue, and this role was for 10 million. And so they weren't talking about the fact that one of their key accomplishments was growing and developing this really large organization. And so make sure as you talk about your accomplishments that you bring numbers into this, because it needs to be relevant, and it needs to be relevant to the role, and ways that you can quantify things are going to be really important. Strengths and weaknesses, what are the strengths related to the role? Weaknesses are not related to the role. So, if you're going into a quantitative role, you certainly don't want to be talking about your Excel modeling. You can be talking about things that you've gotten feedback over the years that you're aware of. For example, you got feedback on your public speaking or presentation skills, and while you have improved, you recognize that's something that you're doing, and you've joined a Toastmasters, or you're just paying special attention to your public speaking. So that's kind of the format on how to answer the weakness question. So these classic questions is probably about 50 to 60% of an interview. And then you get to the behavioral questions. And behavioral questions are looking for specific competencies and attributes that they're looking for. So it usually begins with the, tell me about a time when you made a mistake, how did you respond? Delivered work under pressure. Had to work with someone you did not like or get along with. Work in a team to accomplish a goal. Needed to make a decision with incomplete information. You need to be able to structure these responses, because you're going to get behavioral questions. In preparing for behavioral interviews, there are the classic story frameworks that you can implement. One is STAR. Situation, task, action, result. One is CAR, circumstance, action, result. One is PAR, problem, action, result. And one is SCS, situation, complication, solution. Whatever framework you want to use, use these frameworks to be able to tell these specific instances in work that you've done. So let's take PAR for example. So the PAR framework begins with PAR. So with the problem, what was the challenge you were facing when you began the role, and who were the stakeholders, internal and external? Action, what was your thinking in evaluating your options? Why did you take the approach you took? What specific actions did you take to meet these challenges? Who saw your work? Results, what resulted from it? So I was working with a government contracting exec, and he, again, going for a C-suite role, he had interacted with the board, the leadership team, the staff. There was a private equity transaction that was taking place. And so often he would use the term we. And it's great to talk about how you like to work with others. We did this and we did that. And no doubt you've heard of other people that say, well, I did this and I did that. And the problem, help me understand who were the stakeholders. So we went from we to saying, okay, working with the leadership team, the board, key staff, private equity execs, to be able to do X. And then the results was, okay, we reduced costs, we were able to get a favorable price on the transaction, and we were able to make a successful exit of this division. And so that's how you can tell specific instances of your success using a particular framework, because you're going to get these behavioral questions. And remember to time your stories somewhere between 90 seconds to 2 minutes, because remember that interviewing is not dinner conversation. You know, all the classic interviewers, the radio shows, the TV shows, they all have a start time and an end time. And so you want to make sure that you're telling your story in a very conversational way, and you're not taking forever to do it. I was working with a finance exec who had 25 plus years experience, and he would say to me, Jason, I just go in and give my 10-minute monologue. And I said to him, no, you can't do that, because 10 minutes is an eternity. So answer the question, cut it down to 2 minutes, and then as they're getting to know you, you're able to bring out that other 8 minutes in other places. And sure enough, in his next set of interviews, he was able to use that new strategy and came back to me and he said, you know, I was able to say everything I wanted to say, just not in that succession. And I said, great, because you were able to break it out into smaller pieces. And the way that I like to break this out into smaller pieces is using a 4x4. And so let me show you what I'm talking about. So to make a 4x4, I want everybody to read the job spec and read it a couple of times. What are the qualifications? What are the preferred qualifications? And so you begin to get an understanding of what this job is really about and what are the most important elements. You're going to find that from the job spec. You're going to find that from the people that you've spoken to in your informational conversations. So then begin to write down. So in my 4x4, I've just put change and adaptability, passion, and work ethic. These are only filler points. For you, it could be a really quantitative role. And so you're going to need to show your quantitative ability. This could be a consulting role. And so you're going to need to talk about your consulting projects. Whatever that looks like in the top, that's going to come from the job spec, qualifications, preferred qualifications. Then on the left-hand side, story one, story two, story three, story four, this is all taking your PAR, your STAR, your SES, and then aligning a specific story with a qualification or preferred qualification that's coming from the job spec. And so there might be one story that hits actually two of the qualifications depending on how you adjust it. And so by preparing a 4x4, that allows for you to go in with your four best stories, your four best case studies. These are representative examples of your success. And so, between the classic questions and your behavioral questions using a 4x4, you've hit probably 85% of the questions that you're going to get in an interview. And then, questions for me? You bet. And so then you bring back all the successful things you've been doing in your informational interviews and go back and reverse pyramid on them, being curious. What's the main challenge you're facing right now? And tell me more about the role and why it was created. In your opinion, what are the two or three essential elements to succeed in this role? How does this role support your work? How does this role support the work of your boss? How do you like to lead and manage? What do you like about the work and the people of this organization? Describe the culture of the team department. How did you get to your employer? There are a whole host of questions that you can be asking, because at the end of the day, the separator, the real separator, is creating that chemistry with the person in front of you. So show curiosity. Bring out your inner talk show host, because then you can really show how you're engaged with the person in front of you. And so when you go into your actual interviews, you want to be passionate like Larry. I mean, he has been around for decades, and even at the age that he's at, I still love how he comes in and brings that excitement, that interest into every single interview that he does. So let's talk about interview formats. You're going to get the phone screen. You're going to get the video, the Skype. And I would even say in video and Skype, there's even taped interviews. Seeing a lot more taped interviews where you need to just talk into the screen and they capture your response. There's in person and then there's panel. So let's talk a little bit about each. Phone screen pointers. Prepare as if it was an in-person interview, because if you don't pass the phone screen, you're not getting in person. Use a landline if possible. And I know this is kind of old school in 2017, but if you have a landline, it's certainly going to be helpful, if not be in a place where you get all the bars on your phone. Have printouts of your resume, prepared questions, key organization information, and other research in front of you. Smile and be positive. Smile so that your voice comes through. A lot of research on smiling. Sometimes I even have clients, put mirrors in front of them so that they have the opportunity to smile and kind of, work their mouth a little bit. Ensure that you are being curious about the interviewer as well as the role. Get the interviewer talking in the beginning. So you can be a little bit chatty. How's your day going? How's the weather by you? How are things? Nothing wrong in being a little chatty in the beginning. make sure to answer the question asked. I cannot tell you how many mid-career professionals and executives lose the interview on not answering the question that was asked. So you've prepared a whole host of things. Make sure that you understand the question they are asking you. If you don't understand the question, qualify it with, well, if I hear what you're saying, are you asking me this? So make sure you understand what they are asking you. It's really important. Keep your responses short to get feedback from your interviewer, and this makes timing your responses even more important. Silence is okay because they're probably taking notes on you, so don't use filler words or any of those kinds of things. Let the silence take place so that they can write down what they need to write down. So if you get a video conference or Skype or a taped interview, again, prepare as if it was in person, be curious, smile, and be positive. Ensure you're comfortable with the technology, so make sure to mock Skype with somebody. Keep yourself in view. Your head and shoulders is definitely ideal. You want to find a quiet spot so that you're the only one on screen. Shut off all other technology so you're not disturbing the conversation. Make sure the backdrop is a backdrop that is something that does not distract from you. So it can either be a clear backdrop or with books in the background, whatever it is. But make sure it's not distracting the interviewer from talking with you. Understand your voice vis-a-vis the microphone. Watch the background noise, such as clicking pens, moving things, playing with paper. Make sure that it's just completely clear that you're talking to the person and that they're able to connect with you. And again, answer the question they asked, not the question you wish they asked. In person. All right, same. Smile, be positive, be curious, connect with them. It'd be great to get the interviewer talking. Show up 15 to 20 minutes early. On time is late. Last thing you're thinking about before the interview is your own story. Bring a notepad, pen, and extra resume copies. Make sure to take good notes. The extra resume copies are, you'll never know where they might want to have you talk with somebody else. They don't have a copy of your resume. You want to make sure that's in your portfolio. Prepare a list of questions that show your research. Observe your interviewer's energy level and mimic it. So it's really important to get a read on the person in front of you. If you're a person that's naturally up and the person is not as up as you are, you know, be understanding of that and try to align yourself with the person that's interviewing you. And make sure you figure out what they care about. Figure out what they care about, because the more that you can understand the role, the more that you can target your stories, your experiences, your accomplishments based on what the need is, because you've gone from the job spec, what you think the role is, to the person or people that are in a position to hire you and understand what the real piece is on how you would fit into the role and into the team. And again, answer the question that's asked. Panels. Seeing a lot of panels these days. Try to shake hands with each interviewer before and after. Hard to create an individual connection, but at least eye contact with each person. Write down the names of the interviewers at the beginning of the interview and get their business cards. If not, it's not a big deal. You can write a blanket thank you at the end. And I would say use a typewriter approach. Love the typewriter, because what does it do? After you're done typing, you move the thing in the back, and you need to be thinking about that as you're answering your questions. Be a typewriter and make eye contact with each of the people that are on the panel. You can begin your answer with the person who asked you the question and end your answer with the person who asked you that question, but you can be looking at other people on the panel as you're giving that response. Closing your interviewer. Closing your interview. And I love how Barbara closes when she was at 2020. So you're in touch, so let's be in touch. And closing on a high note is really important. The last 5 minutes of the interview, the last 10 minutes of the interview, show interest and excitement for the role, team, and employer at the end of the conversation. I feel like there's a really great fit. I've enjoyed this conversation. Handle any objections. So it's not unusual to say, are there any reservations you might have about my candidacy? Get business cards. Ask about next steps in the process. Are you going to, so you're interviewing other people. I should hear back in a couple of weeks. 12 hours to send an email. Thank you. If you really want the job, I'm a big fan of sending a follow-up written note. And when you're writing your thank you notes, make sure that you've handled any objections. You're speaking to their interests, their needs, their views. It is about them. So, quick interview recap thoughts. First, be yourself. Enjoy the process. Interviewing is awesome. I love interviewing. Interviewing is such a wonderful way for you to connect with people in front of you, and it's an essential skill set because you're moving from interview to offer is extremely key in a successful job search. Informational interviewing is key to successful interviewing. I can't say this enough. This is where you can practice asking questions and understanding what lands and understanding what people care about and how things resonate. So big, big fan of informational interviewing. Use your knowledge from your informational interviews to guide your story. You are the only one to tell it. And so reflect positively on your career. But as you begin to take that next step, think about the conversations that you've had in your informational interviews, and then how can you tie that story together, whether it's a couple of years out or 25 plus years out, so that you can bring a condensed version of you based on what you think the person in front of you is thinking about and caring about. Use a 4x4 to rehearse responses to classic interview questions, like the behaviorals, so that you can get your PAR stories, your STAR stories together, so that you get ready to talk to your very specific accomplishments. Recognize different interview formats, the phone, Skype, panel, in person. Practice, prepare, and repeat, and make sure to time your answers. Ask questions, show curiosity, and be genuine in your interest. You want to interview like Larry, like Barbara, like Jim and Oprah. This is a dialogue. It's not a monologue. Ensure to have a good time. Feel free to keep in touch. Here are some things to consider as you're thinking about engaging me, if you want to engage me. And here's my website, my Twitter handle, and my Facebook page. So if there's time, I'm more than happy to take some questions.
Jason, thank you so much. Fantastic presentation. I have been taking notes myself. We have quite a number of questions that are coming in, so I will go ahead and get started. But as I am doing so, for all of you who still want to get a question out to Jason, now is your time to send that through to me. Jason, let's go ahead and get started with thinking on your feet. I know you addressed this. You may have answered this question already to its fullest, but can you give any more, shed some more light on those who have difficulty thinking on their feet and reacting to certain questions when they come up, especially those that start with, give me an example of, or explain a time when?
Right. And so you, in creating your 4x4, and again, it goes back to thinking of the things that you're most proud of in your background and how that fits into a problem action result story. And then I would also say that once you've got them together and you've timed them, I think you need to rehearse them with somebody so that if they're asking you a tell me about a time when or be able to think on your feet, you have done something in practice that could be relevant to what they're asking for. And again, this goes back to researching the role, the informational interviews, so that you have a hypothesis on what you think they're going to hire you for.
Thank you, Jason. We have another question on ageism. How can one go about preparing for an interview with companies that are they largely hire or seem to hire those who are recent grads or perhaps 5 to 10 years out? How do you prepare yourself for questions about age and experience? And this question is specifically dealing with tech startups, tech industry.
I love tech startups and I love tech industry. And guess what? If you look at a tech startup after 2, 3, 4 years, you start to see gray hair in the room. Why? Because the organization's growing so fast, they need people to manage. And so actually, I think that's an advantage. So as you're telling your story, and as you're talking about your background and experience, a couple of things. One, your comfort level with technology and new age technology, not when you were using floppy disks and WAN computers. The second piece is you want to talk about flexibility and adaptability. So in your 4x4, one of the things that you should be talking about is how you've worked with people across generations, how people that are potentially younger than you have managed you, or you've taken in their ideas to make a better product. And so I think it's really important to hit it head on that, listen, you've got this experience, and you've got experience working with people of all different ages and backgrounds. And so it shows to them that you already have that experience. And so, so you've got, a little bit of more experience than most. I see it as an asset, not as a detriment. And if they don't, then just move on.
Thank you, Jason. How would you recommend that we approach interviews for fields in which our experience is primarily from education and not from the workforce?
So then if you have more education than actual experience, then you're speaking to your motivation. And how excited you are about this role and this company. And so the way that you can separate yourself is to know more about the company and more about what they do and be more excited about it than others. And so where you can show your preparation and your research, and that can be a separator against the other people that are interviewing for a similar role.
Great. Thank you, Jason. Regarding the close, would you consider it appropriate to ask your interviewer if they think, from what they've heard, if I, the individual interviewing, fit the qualifications for the job?
No. That's another way of asking, will you hire me? Or it's another way of saying, do you like me? Go the objections route, because it's not about fitting the qualifications. It's about fitting on the team. So remember, you've gone from job spec to person. And so too often we think of like, all right, have I checked this? Have I checked that? Have I checked this? It's really important for the person that's in the position to hire you and ask them, do they have any objections? Because don't go to qualifications, because everybody hates writing a job spec. Once the job spec is written and you've gotten to final round interviews, it's more important on what they think about you and any objections you might have. So I take it from that perspective.
Jason, we have a question about screening interviews. And this is coming from the alum. If I think the interviewer doesn't really know much about the job and specific needs, I tend to pull back asking important questions because I don't want to put them on the spot. Should I just ask what I need to know or do just enough to get to the decision maker?
So I think you're doing a couple of things and you're doing them right. So yes, sometimes a screener will not have a full understanding of the role. But feel free to ask the questions that you have. And if your screener doesn't understand or your screener doesn't have an answer, they'll be honest. But I would bring the questions that you have, and if there's time for it, I would ask them and go from there.
Jason, if you are in the middle of an interview and you realize that this may not be the best fit for you, should you still act as if it is, or is it appropriate to make that comment that you don't feel that this is actually the best fit for you in the middle of the interview?
No, I would wait till the end. I would wait till the end and wait to see if you get an offer. And because that allows for you and them to, make their decisions. You may not get an offer, and so the point is moot. But if you do get an offer, then you can say, listen, I want to take myself out of the running, or show that you've thought about it, and maybe, you know, 12 hours or 18 hours or, you know, 6 hours. Between, I would say, sometime between the time you interviewed and the next day, say, listen, I really enjoyed everybody. I've come to realize I just don't think there's a fit, and pull yourself out. But I no need to do that right then and there.
Thank you, Jason. Do you recommend doing proposals for potential interviewers with thoughts on business challenges or 30, 60, 90 approaches that you would take?
So typically what organizations will do is round two or round three, they'll have you do those kinds of things. I know that I'm working, you know, when I work with C-suite folks, typically the organization will say, okay, we expect you to give a presentation, or we're expecting you to give, you know, what are you going to do in the first 90 days or the first year, or those kinds of things. So you can have some broad strokes, but if they ask you that in the first interview, it's kind of it's hard to answer because you're not there. You don't know, and you would need some more information. So I would, as you're going into the initial interviews, kind of ask those questions of what will be expected of you. But as you get in further, I would imagine that you'd probably either be giving a proposal or a presentation or something like that. But let them come to you with that.
Jason, we have a specific question in regards to an upcoming interview for a governmental research position. Do you have any recommendations for how one might prepare for something that specific?
So, I mean, a government research position, you know, first and foremost, I would be excited about the research that they're producing. So what are the two or the three pieces of research that have come out that, you know, you find interesting? I would talk about, you know, the areas that you've done research in that are relevant to, you know, is it a specific government agency? Is it a government topic? So what is it about your background that you find enjoyable? If you don't have experience in that particular topic, then give me a representative example of research you've done in other areas that you can show would be of interest to this government research role.
Thank you, Jason. And for one final question, do you have any advice or some suggestions as to how one could go about doing some background research into the internal dynamics of an organization? For example, sitting in on an interview and asking the question, one might not feel they always get the most honest or realistic response.
Well, I think one of the things that you can do, and this is something that I like to consult, you know, my clients to do, is that if you really want to get an understanding of what it's like in the organization, you've done your informational interviews, you've gotten all the research that you can, after you get an offer, I wouldn't do this during the interview stage. After you get the offer, and if you have the time and it's in the same location, I would ask to go back into the organization and talk to those people and ask them, you know, what are the strengths of this team? What are the areas that you see opportunities or areas of development? So, you know, asking those really hard questions can really come after you get the offer, and so that you can get a better understanding on, you know, if this is a fit for you or not.
Great. Jason, thank you so much. Fantastic presentation. So full of meaty information. Our alumni have been sending through so many positive responses and feedback. For any questions that we have not gotten to, Jason has left his email address, so please feel free to reach out to Jason. He's also fantastic for coaching, so we do recommend him. You can actually check out more of Jason's webinars on our ACS YouTube channel by searching under Jason's name for more there. And again, I will be sending you a recording of this presentation in my email over the next few days. Jason, thank you once again from Georgetown.
Thank you, Kara. Thank you, everybody.
Hoya Saxa, and we hope to see you soon. Thank you so much.
Hoya Saxa.